I also request other panelists to please rename themselves. Good afternoon, Arun ji. Good afternoon, sir. Request you to please rename yourself. I think you're on mute, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, Ankur. This is Dr. Sujit Ranjan.
Okay, sir. I'll just. I did it for you. Mallika ma'am, also request you to please leave. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Dr. Chindi. This is Dipankar. Vikram sir, I've got your presentation, so if you want, I can say that.
Yes, please, just if you can
just give me a second.
Yes, wrong me, sir.
I think it is the right presentation.
This is the one.
Perfect. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I think we are just waiting for some other panels and then we can go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon, sir. Nice to see you after a long time.
Thank you. Nice seeing all of you. All the very best. Thank you.
How have you been doing, sir?
Yeah, it's all fine. Going on as usual.
Yeah. Hello, Dr. Sujit.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon,
sir.
Mallika ji,
Dipti
ji.
Yeah, Dr. Mallika, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm good, sir. How are you?
Yeah, long time. We see you now.
It's been a really long time, sir.
Mallika ma'am, I think you have joined from two systems, so it's echoing. The voice is echoing.
Yeah, I think that has to be controlled.
I think it is better now.
Yes, it's better. Perfect.
Good afternoon, Dr. Dipti. Yeah, muted.
Dipti Gulati ma'am was on mute.
Okay.
ये कौन है तेरे मिस बोलना मिसेस बोलनी है या मिस को
मिस
मिसी बोलना
हाँ
मिसी मिसेस नहीं
है सर पर है ना सर
अच्छा
मिसेस ना
हो मिसेस बोलिए मिस अच्छा लगता है लड़कियों को
Hi Vivek. Hello Sujit.
Good afternoon, madam. Good afternoon.
So good to see you after a long time.
Yeah, good. Nice seeing you again. I know we'll be meeting quite frequently, but now it is all mostly on
the
virtual mode. But anyway, yes. It was. Yeah, lots of you know, you will be coming to next time anyway, very frequently.
I just spoke at Sri Naveen Ji's office. I mean, Dr. Rajiv Naveen Jain's office. So he's joining in 2-3 minutes. You can go ahead after that. I also request other panelists to please rename themselves and please open their cameras while we all can see you.
Yeah, Mr. Dipankar, this is Sujit Ranjan.
Hi, Dipankar. This is Shetil. Good evening, everyone. Hi. You want the cameras on, or we can switch them off?
It all depends on you. No, not a problem. Mr. Dhabriyal is also about to join from.
Yeah.
Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar to all. And I'm Dhabriyal Dhabriya from PhD CCI.
Namaskar.
Dr. Yogesh, thank you so much for joining. So, everyone, please meet Dr. Yogesh Srivastav. Assistant Secretary General at PhD Chamber of Commerce.
Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to each one of you. As my colleague has already introduced me, so I'm not reintroducing myself. But it's a real pleasure, to interact on the occasion of this webinar, a very important webinar on towards improved nutrition challenges future strategies, which we are basically going to talk, and thanks to Hexagon Nutrition, who are has played a very important role while organizing this webinar. We also welcome our each and every concerned stakeholders those who have joined today, and a very warm welcome to each and every speaker, those who are here today with us on this great occasion, where we are going to have deliberation for next at least 2 hours on the challenges and future strategies towards improved nutrition. Ladies and gentlemen, we also have Mr. Digvijay Dhabaria. He's chair of the Rajasthan chapter of PhDCCI. And let me not take much of time. Let me request Mr. Dhabaria to kindly give his opening remarks. Over to you, Mr. Dhabaria.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello? My sound is okay?
Okay.
Yes. Please go ahead. Sir, very much audible, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. Happy Navaratri to all and good afternoon, everyone. I have a pleasure in welcome our chief guest, Sri Naveen Jain sir, IAS Secretary, Department of Food, Civil Supplies and Consumer Affairs, Government of Rajasthan. Our other guest, Dr. C. Vasudevanappa, Honorable Vice Chancellor, NIFTEM, Sri Vikram Kelkar, Managing Director, Hexagon Nutrition, Ms. Deepthi Gulati, Nutrition and Public Health Specialist, Ms. Cheryl Salis, Founder, Nutrition Health Solutions, Dr. Siddharth Vagulkar, Deputy Head, Nutrition and School Feeding Unit, WFP India, Dr. Srimao Nair, Professor, Department of Food and Nutrition, the MS University of Baroda, Dr. Suji Ranjan, Public Health and Nutrition Specialist, Mr. Vivek Arora, Principal Lead, FFRC Food Fortification Resource Center, Dr. Yogesh Srivastava, Assistant Secretary General, PhDCCI. Friends from media and industry, academic institutes, and all the delegates. A large part of the population of our country suffers from the acute malnutrition. 1/3 of about 2 billion people who are suffering from vitamin and micronutrient deficiencies globally are in India. India has a high prevalence of micronutrient deficiency related health risks of micronutrient deficiency caused by vitamin A, iodine, iron, and folic acid, leading to night blindness, goiter, anemia, and various birth defects, which can improve by food fortification. Over the years, food fortification has become an efficient tool to combat the deficiencies of the vitamin and mineral in our diet. Fortification is the process of addition of the key vitamins and minerals such as iron, iodine, zinc, vitamin A and D to staple foods such as rice, pulses, wheat, oil, milk, and salt to improve their nutritional content. Fortification process has helped eliminate vitamin and mineral malnutrition in many developing countries. Fortification is a globally proven intervention to address the much prevalent micronutrient deficiencies in the population. Reducing vitamin and mineral deficiencies is an important tool in achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. Fortification is a relatively inexpensive strategy benefiting everyone who eats fortified food, and it does not require consumers to change behavior. Research in India suggests that food fortification improves biological remarks. Iron and hemoglobin levels specially improves when fortified with MMN, multiple micronutrients, or iron MMN fortification is reported to have a better impact on the health than use of a single fortificant. While current government nutrition program, especially those that target children, are good avenues for implementing such beneficial food fortification. However, despite the continued research and education on malnutrition, the bigger challenge like malnutrition still exists. The discussion today will focus on the efficient strategies in combating challenges like malnutrition, which will ultimately help in achieving goals of making nutrition available to all through food fortification. I'm sure that this first of its kind webinar will not only create awareness about the potential and encourage investment in the fortification and nutrition sector under Make in India and Atmanirbhar Bharat policies. I once again welcome you all and wish success for the webinar. I'm also thankful to our sponsor, Hexagon Nutrition, for their contribution in making this webinar success. Thank you, Jai Hind.
Thank you, Mr. Dabaria. Thank you very much for your brief, wonderful opening remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, very good afternoon to you once again. And I really take this opportunity once again to welcome our chief guest, Shri Naveen Jainji. He's the IAS, Secretary Department of Food, Civil Supplies and Consumer Affairs, Government of Rajasthan. And I must confess that this is such a fantastic program. More than 70 people have already joined, and we have got a registration of more than 100 people, those who are going to join today. I would like to extend once again my heartiest thanks to Dabaria Saab, to you for making this opening remarks and a fantastic start of this webinar. And as you all are aware, for the benefit of for our participants, we have our guest, Dr. C. Vasudevappa, Honorable Vice Chancellor, NIFTEM. It was my proud privilege to visit NIFTEM. I think this was pre-corona in 2017-18 when I was there. Such a fantastic institute. I was there with my colleague Mallika and could interact with number of professors over there. I would love to come once again, sir. It's such a pleasure since it is near to Delhi. I would love to come once again and interact with the students, because food processing is one of a very important and very, sectors which are affecting most of our countrymen. We have Shri Vikram Kelkar also, Managing Director, Hexagon Nutrition. We welcome him. Ms. Dipi Gulati, Nutrition and Public Health Specialist. Ms. Shreya Salis, Founder, Nurture Health Solution. Dr. Siddharth, Deputy Head, Nutrition and School Feeding Unit, WFP India. Dr. Simarao Nair, Professor, Department of Foods and Nutrition. And Dr. Sujit Ranjan, Public Health and Nutrition Specialist. Mr. Vivek Arora, Principal Lead, FFRC, Food Fortification Resource Center. We welcome each and every speaker of the day, those who have found time and then gracing this important webinar. With this note now, ladies and gentlemen, let me request now Shri Vikram Kelkar ji, who would be giving the welcome address. And he's, as I have said, he's the Managing Director of Hexagon Nutrition. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Yogesh Srivastav. It's a pleasure to be here on this forum. It's the first webinar of PhD Chambers that we are part of. And also, thank you very much, Mr. Digvijay Dabaria, for your opening remarks. And my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Vasudevappa to be a part of this forum, and also Shri Naveen Jain, who has been a pioneer in the, working towards the area of eradicating malnutrition since many, many years now. Great contributions done by him. And also the esteemed panelists, we have who's who in this forum today, right from the academia to the government, to the non-government, to the supranational organizations, UN organizations, the industry, and many more. So before anything, I would like to make a small presentation as I speak. So I request Deepankar to please upload the presentation.
Is it visible?
Yes, very much to me. And can you go to the slideshow, please? Great. So let me speak today on challenges and opportunities in nutraceutical industry with a focus on malnutrition and food fortification. Next slide, please. So nutraceuticals is a broad term referred to food or parts of food that provide incremental health benefits and can be segregated under three broad heads. The first being the functional food and beverages, micronutrient and micronutrient premixes, and dietary supplements. And the nutraceutical industry today is regulated by the FSSAI under various regulations, which are mentioned. Next slide, please. So factors driving growth of nutraceutical markets in India. So there are a host of factors which drive the growth of nutraceutical industry in India. Notable among them are malnutrition status in India and micronutrient deficiency, increasing concern about nutrition awareness and access to information that has led to an increase in the use of health supplements and nutraceuticals, affluence of the working population with changing lifestyles and dietary patterns, and increase in the disposable income, increasing costs of hospitalization that are driving consumers towards health supplements and nutraceuticals, and then the FSSAI food fortification regulations. Next slide, please. So coming to the supply drivers, so with India transforming into a global manufacturing hub, there is a strong impetus for the nutraceutical product manufacturers to set up their production facilities in India. Strong economic growth with encouraging macroeconomic indicators, strategic location with access to all major shipping routes, low cost of labor, large pool of technical and skilled labor, easy availability of ingredients, strong distribution networks, coupled with the accessibility of products through e-commerce. Next slide, please. So India's nutraceutical market is poised to be one of the fastest growing market at $4 to $5 billion. Some experts and reports even suggested that it will grow to approximately $18 billion by 2025. Let me also give you an overview of the growth of the nutraceutical market globally. Next slide, please. So the nutraceuticals market will accelerate at a CAGR of 8% from 2020 to 24. The global market will reach $336 billion by 2024. Currently, the USA, Japan, and Europe account for majority of the market, almost 90%. The focus of nutraceutical players is now shifting towards developing economies, especially those across Asia Pacific, including India. And the demand for nutraceuticals with health benefits, change in lifestyle are the two key factors driving the market growth. Next slide, please. So it is said that smooth seas do not make skillful sailors. It's through the challenges that we learn and keep growing. It is also important that the policy makers and stakeholders should get into a public-private partnership and build and foster this growing nutraceutical industry. Let's see the challenges that are faced by the nutraceutical industry today. So the first being the changing regulatory climate. Several amendments are happening due to the growing nature of the nutraceutical industry, right from the product definitions and approvals to health claims and manufacturing standards. Look-alike products. The Indian nutraceutical market has a high threat of look-alike fraudulent products, which confuses the consumer and dents the trust in natural products. Then higher pricing for imported products and inputs. Although the demand for nutraceuticals is expected to rise considerably, high prices limit their adoption in the Indian market. Additionally, for the India market entry for the imported products, the import tariffs need to be considered when determining the final pricing of the products. And then finally, tailoring the products to domestic tastes and preferences. The Indian population preferences include vegetarianism, halal, or the Hindu dietary practices, and the traditional remedies for reflecting social and cultural diversity. It is important for the brands to be mindful that the demand for a product may vary according to the dietary preference or religion. Next slide, please. It is said that change brings in new opportunities. Since 2 years, we are looking at the changes that are taking place in and around us. Education has gone digital. People communicate with each other digitally. COVID too has impacted the nutraceutical industry in some way. Next slide, please. So a study done by Mintel revealed that the demand for vitamin A, C, and D and zinc supplements have spiked in the last 7 months. Youngsters below 30 years old have started to prioritize their spending on nutraceuticals. There's a shift from buying nutraceutical products from specific health issues such as osteoporosis, arthritis, hypertension, to immunity building nutraceuticals. One of the most significant trends is that there is an increase in the in-home indulgence as a way of seeking small pleasures. Next slide, please. So the immunity-based products will have a continued demand post-COVID-19. Targeting other factors affecting immunity can be the key in formulating immunity products, such as for combating stress, sleep deprivation, and improving gut health. And then tap into new dosage formats, branching beyond the usual supplements format. Few emerging formats are tea, coffee shots, nutrition bars, table spread, gummies, cheese, almond milk with DHA, and meal replacement products. Finally, making products more enjoyable to consume. This will help boost the usage frequency. Next slide, please. Malnutrition. Malnutrition refers to the deficiencies or excesses in nutrient intake, imbalance of essential nutrients, or impaired nutrient utilization. Next slide, please. Can we move on? Yeah, thank you. So globally, 37.9% of children under 5 years of age are stunted. 20.8% of children under 5 years are wasted, compared to the Asia average of 22.7% that are stunted and 9.4% that are wasted. Next slide, please. Majorly, there are three strategies to eradicate micronutrient deficiencies. The first being the supplementation. A safe and efficient strategy to eliminate micronutrient deficiencies. It is available in capsules and syrups. Unfortunately, the government of India programs reach only about 55% of the population, and compliance is also an issue. Then we have the dietary diversification. The vast majority of people today simply cannot access or afford a healthy diet. Affordability of a diversified diet is also a big question. Then finally, we come to the third, that is the staple food fortification. It's a good option as staple food for consumption is very high. Fortification process is easy. Potential to reach all the income groups. Does not require changes in eating habits. And it's very cost effective, less than 0.1% of the MRP. But unfortunately, only very few foods that are available in the market today are fortified. I hope that we get to see much more in the future. Next slide, please. Food fortification is globally proven intervention to address the much prevalent micronutrient deficiencies in the population. Fortification means adding key vitamins and minerals, amino acids and enzymes, which are either absent or present in small amounts. It is the fastest and the cheapest strategies to reach hundreds of millions with improved intakes of essential micronutrients through food fortification. The practice of adding one or more essential nutrients to a widely consumed food. Next slide, please. There are numerous advantages of food fortification. Some of them are listed below. Reduces critical micronutrient deficiencies. Population-wide approach. From children to elderly, anyone consuming staples will get these micronutrients, ensuring maximum impact. Then no changes in the dietary habits. Commodities selected for fortification are already commonly consumed staples, for example, oil, milk, wheat flour, rice, and salt. This has nothing to do with the diversified diet that is being consumed on a daily basis. Finally, fortification does not lead to change in any color, texture, or the taste of the fortified food. Excellent return on investment. Eliminating deficiencies creates healthy, productive populations and proves to provide one of the highest social return on investment. And it is extremely affordable and inexpensive, yet has a strong impact. Next slide, please. Coming to the public-private partnership. A strong public-private partnership between the food industry, development partners, and the government institutions in scaling up nutrition inventions is the need of the hour. From the industry side, they need to ensure the processing and fortifying the foods. Then setting up sustainable systems for uninterrupted supply chain of food and supporting distribution of nutritional kits in high burden districts under the CSR activities. In case of the development partners, on-ground implementation and support, creating awareness about nutrition and related issues through multimedia campaigns, forging technical collaborations to scale up nutrition and public health interventions. In case of government institutions, it is ensuring availability and accessibility of safe and nutritious food to the nutritionally vulnerable population groups through different channels, implementing policy decisions and validation, and finally, to augment government's efforts to address nutritional issues. Next slide, please. We have Atmanirbhar Bharat, an important aspect to consider, and that is the export potential that can be tapped through this scheme. At Hexagon, we make in India and export across the world. Next slide, please. We are a complete nutrition solution provider. So when you sit with your family on a dining table, you need everything that will contain our micronutrients in it, because we care for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Shri Vikram Kelkar, Managing Director, Hexagon Nutrition. I think, yes, nutrition is very, very important, as you said, not only for ourselves, but for our entire loved ones and for our family. I have just now been told, ladies and gentlemen, it's a correction on my part that Mr. Vivek Arora is the FFRC FSSAI, not the principal lead. Request, kindly note the same, that he is FFRC FSSAI. So ladies and gentlemen, post this welcome address by Shri Vikram Kelkarji. Now it is my proud privilege to invite for the special address on policy perspective and support for sustaining and scaling of food fortification. We have Dr. C. Vasudevappa, Honorable Vice Chancellor of NIFTEM. As I have said, one of the very inspiring places I could see, this is pre-corona, and the students and the faculty over here is fantastic, I must say. And it would be a very nice thing if I can visit once again, Professor Sir, and then interact with you people. And wherever you feel any support from PhDCCI, that would always be there. Over to you, sir, for your special address.
Thank you, Yogesh ji, and good afternoon, everybody. And most respected Sri Naveen Jain, sir, who is, of course, most related person here today from the Department of Food and Civil Supplies from Government of Rajasthan. And very nice to listen to Mr. Vikram Kelkar, whom I think we have been interacting quite frequently from Hexagon Nutrition. And of course, we do have Digvijay Dabriyaji from, I know, especially from Polywood Limited, and others, especially Ms. Deepthi Gulati, whom we have been interacting very frequently, of course. Cheryl Villiers, I think, Sally's, I think she has been with us for the fortification issues. And all the other, I would say, the panelists and delegates. This is a very important session of the day, I would say. For the simple reason, I know we are in India. We are really, and I would say, having a very huge burden of malnutrition. Malnutrition, not necessarily it is the imbalance in the nutrient composition, but there are some small, minor and micronutrients which need to be imbibed into the food. Only then we will be completing our nutritional aspects. Otherwise, you know, we still continue to be at a very high level in terms of the hunger index in the world. We were at 103. We are slowly, you know, coming down, maybe about say 87 or 88 today. So that means still, I would say, India is regarded as a poor country in the others' eyes. But it is all not because that we are economically poor, because we are, I would say, healthily very, very poor compared to others. Probably that is where I think we need to understand, especially our expenditure on health has been the highest in the world. So believe me, India, though it's specialized to that extent, probably I think because of the health issues or because of the dietary issues, we are unnecessarily spending more money on health than any other person in US or Europe. So we need to understand this. Probably I would say that here, even the surveys conducted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, which really emphasizes that malnutrition and micronutrient deficiency diseases could be the iodine deficiency, could be the, I would say, the vitamin and deficiency, vitamin A and D and things like that. Probably, I think, these are scaring, I would say, things. But all the same, it's our duty today to build awareness amongst the people, the necessity and the requirement of these nutrients in the food. And probably the industry, as has been said in the whole topic, scaling up. Scaling up is something which is very, very important. I'm pretty sure that many people, many industry will enter into this arena. Already we are seeing a lot of such products coming out from different industries. But again, I would like to just make a mention here. Fortification is just not, you know, adding up some of the nutrients and trying to say that the food is fortified. But basically, we need to look at its utility, its absorption capacity, the digestive coefficient. All those things need to be looked in. That means real science is involved in fortification. It is not bringing in some vitamins, minerals, and all that and putting into the food and say that it is fortified. This is what is being misconceived, and many industries are trying to say that we are doing fortification, which I would say is not correct scientifically speaking. That's what I want to just highlight here. And of course, I know, so it affects the entire strata of the population, not necessarily the affluent or even the poor. Everybody is affected, because now we are influenced by most of the modern foods, which are, I would say, lacking the balanced nutrition. Probably, I think, you know, it is not far, days are not far. Then we come up with a lot of new, you know, foodstuffs or new products, which can be really fortified, which can be made tasty, even much better than, you know, the products that are available outside. And unfortunately, we are fancied and we are carried away by the shape and the color and the, I don't know, and some things which are more chemicals. Which can give you some, you know, instant taste and all that, but they are not good for the health. I think that's where we need to look at. In fact, as has been emphasized by FSSAI, fat, salt, and all these things need to be really, you know, at a low level, but at the same time, the food has to be of good quality. That's where I would re-emphasize again. I know, of course, micronutrients means not necessary. It's only the vitamins and minerals. There are smaller requirements, maybe even some of the herbs, which can also play a major role in fortification. The extracts from herb also can help us in fortification. We need to look at all these requirements very critically. And probably, I think, only then we'll be addressing the real issues, which are really, you know, specially required for the population, which depends on food for their health. You know, even today, we know all that. Probably in the rural India, if you go, still our food is a cereal-based food. We consume on an average, Indian average, if you look at, about 300 grams of cereals every day. And probably if you look at the even oil also, it's about 20, 25 grams. People feel eating more oil is a luxury. No, there we need to really be careful. Because I know a lot of these fried stuffs are coming where there will be a lot of oil in it, which can also create more major problems. In fact, there are certain factors within these oils which can create, especially fried oil, if it is reused, again, there are issues. So we need to look at these things probably. That is, again, very, very important. And that apart, of course, I know we need to understand the importance of these fruits and vegetables in our diet. So this is, unfortunately, to a certain extent, now it is improving, but altogether it is forgotten in many areas. Maybe even the egg and fish and meat, they can be of plant origin type of things which are coming up, the analogs are coming up. So, sorry. That's where I feel we have to do justice even in terms of fortification. So coming to the, I would say, even the three key strategies which are specially identified, as has been said by Mr. Kelkar, it is the nutrient deficiency we need to overcome, maybe through diversified foods. I know diversification is the key today, because I know now we have understood eating only rice doesn't help. So that means we mix with many other cereals or vegetables, fruits and all that. That's what is the diversification. That is what one thing where science has to play a major role. People should understand, I would say, the nutrient composition of different ingredients. That is very important. Unless we have that information, probably we will not be able to come up with a real, you know, food which can really meet our nutrient deficiencies, especially the micronutrient deficiencies. That apart, of course, I know micronutrient supplementation, which has been going on for a long time. So we need to bring in science here. That's all. Absolutely. It's not that we are doing something wrong, but we are doing something which 100% is not really accepted or to the human body. That has to be looked in seriously. Of course, the third aspect is food fortification. I know. Sorry. So fortification has been a major, I would say, area and an answer for many of these things, because they, we take care of everything, including it is a science-based fortification where we really understand what is it really required and how is it is going to be absorbed and utilized and how is it is going to help. I would say even fortification is nothing but, I would say, your nutraceutical. So it's a nutraceutical, in fact, in terms of functional food, in terms of targeted requirements of vitamins, minerals, and proteins. All this is from, of course, from the fortification. And I would say that here, again, this is a very important area where we need to work very seriously. Even the World Health Organization has, and even, of course, I would say, even the government of India, I would say, through Poshak Abhiyan, I think this is a very important initiative which has been taken forward. Just 1 minute. I'm sorry, I don't know. So it's a very cost-effective method, as has been said by Ms. Kelkar. So we need to look at this, the requirement, seriously, and especially it helps in reducing the micronutrient deficiency amongst the population across the whole globe. That's where I think, you know, we need to really understand. I know FSSAI has been a nodal agency as far as the standards are concerned. There are standards which are stipulated. We need to follow that. And that apart, I would say here, the oil, milk, wheat flour, rice, and double fortified salt have been gazetted. So this information is very important for each one of us. Probably, I think we need to look at these things very, very critically. And the fortification of staple food has been the major directive, not only from WHO, even the Honorable Prime Minister of India has been emphasizing by 2024, we should come up with the fortified rice, because rice is one commodity which has been consumed in a very large quantities across the whole country. Probably go to South, especially I would say Tamil Nadu or Karnataka and Kerala and all that, 100% it is rice-based food. Even Maharashtra to a certain extent, but you come north slowly after Madhya Pradesh and all that, probably wheat is slightly replacing the rice. But that being the scenario, even rice for, not only I would say rice fortification, I would say we have identified nutri-cereals like the millets. Now the millets, good. They are for certain things very good. But is it a complete, complete thing? There also I would re-emphasize that we need to go for a fortified flours of such of these products, which can really be very useful and very helpful for the human health. I think that is one thing which I would say nowadays we have been giving more emphasis for the millets. That's fine. Sorry, I don't know, something happened.
No problem, sir. We will be bothering you in the next session also. So tea is going to be a great nutrition at this point in time. So you must have some tea. Please complete this thing so that I can ask the next speaker.
Okay, fine. I think I would stop at this point. Anyway, I have one more session. That time I will take up the other issues which are really essentially required to address this this problem. How NIFTEM is getting involved, how we want to really promote the science behind this, all that probably I'll talk later. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Please take some rest, take a lot of warm water, maybe a herbal tea would certainly help, but a very fantastic special addresser on your part. And then, of course, NIFTEM is playing a very important role and will play a very important role, in this direction. Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to request the chief guest of the day, Shri Naveen Jainji, is from Indian Administrative Service, Secretary, Department of Food, Civil Supplies and Consumer Affairs, Government of Rajasthan. I will not take much of time and I will request Jain Sahab to kindly give his inaugural address. Over to you, sir.
Thank thank you very much. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Very much audible, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. So, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this webinar. And definitely, I'm also looking forward to get some insights from many experts there. So, PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry and the Dr. C. Vasudevappa, who is the Vice Chancellor of NIFTM. I just want to add some perspective from an administration point of view, from an administrator point of view, when a collector thinks about the malnutrition problem in his district or a secretary thinks about this problem in the state. So what ideas or what are the insights or thoughts should come to their minds? In this particular assignment as Secretary Food, unfortunately, we have nothing more to add because like many other states in India, we are also struggling to introduce fortified things. There are some achievements in Rajasthan because of the efforts by many organizations in recent years. Normally, we enter into the kitchen of a normal household by five ways if you want to introduce fortified commodities. The first of them is salt. There has been a lot of talks on the fortified salt thing, how to add iron and iodine in such a way that it is sustainable as well as it is cheap, because rural people will not spend more than 10 rupee a kg, I think. So how to make sure that salt is available at a cheaper price and still it has all the potentials of iodine and iron components. Then second way is milk. Thankfully, Rajasthan has been able to have fortified milk because the main supplier in Rajasthan is our own Sir's Dairy, which is Government of Rajasthan initiative. So there we have been adding the required micronutrients, and the Government of Rajasthan's effort has been seen very nicely by other states at national level also. Third is oil, and oil is now coming with all the essential vitamin and other micronutrients. So there is no issue regarding oil. I think there will be hardly any company now which is not adding the required micronutrients in the cooking oil. Then comes rice. Here, the progress is not as per the mandate because I think we are talking about fortified rice for a long time. But as a food secretary, I have been informed that half of the districts in my own state, Rajasthan, will be getting fortified rice from this month. And that too in two schemes, to start with two schemes, which are a part of government safety net program. We all know about midday meal schemes in schools. We all know about ICDS system in Anganwadi. I don't want to waste any time in describing what is midday meal or what is ICDS scheme. We are listening about these schemes for some decades now. What I want to say that if we can supply fortified rice in sufficient quantity, and it may not be a formality that, you know, a certain amount is added in a bag full of rice. I think some scientific study would be done, some exercise will be conducted by FCI, that is Food Corporation of India, and other suppliers of food. Then I think it will be really achieved. So by March 22, I have been told that all children in Rajasthan who are enrolled in ICDS or midday meal will be given fortified rice. So in one way, we are happy that at least a part of micronutrients will come into their diet through fortified rice. Then next thing is, and the last one is the flour, the wheat flour. Rajasthan had tried its hands in giving fortified wheat flour from 2012 to 2014. And it was done with some success, but there were many issues which came up later on. There were reports of complaints by villagers that the color of the flour is not as they were thinking of. And there were many small petty issues which were raised, but I think they were not handled well, or I don't know, there were issues in supplies. Because in Rajasthan, let me tell you one figure, that we give wheat to around 4.4 crore people. it's 44 million people we are giving to. So around more than 20 lakh quintal wheat per month. So you can estimate the logistics of supplying wheat in Rajasthan. And Rajasthan is a very big state geographically with very low density of population in some areas. We have deserts, we have tribal area, we have forest areas, and logistics difficult to ensure 45 also reaches to the persons who are getting wheat. Wheat can be handled easily. Wheat has a good shelf life, and these days it is not there is no danger of wheat getting, you know, contaminated by anything. So it is easy to handle wheat as a commodity to be given through fair price shops. But when it comes of converting wheat into fortified flour, there are many issues involved. You need millers, you need honest millers, you need honest transporters. A lot of honesty will be expected from the system, apart from government department, apart from fair price dealers, who are normally termed as dishonest in a BDS system. But even you need to have an eye on the millers and the transporters also, so that the purpose is achieved. We should not be worried about the things that, you know, what will happen to our wheat. Once it is released from the FCI godowns to producers in their factories, what will happen? So I think we need to make a very foolproof program, and everybody has to support this program so that we can achieve target of giving fortified wheat flour to 4.4 crore people of Rajasthan who are currently under NFSA. And when it comes of giving extra wheat, like Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, like in which 5 kg per person is given free of cost by Government of India along with NFSA wheat. So logistics become again a nightmare, and when it comes of distributing wheat in such a proportion, really, I can tell you, it is not an easy thing. You have to get a lot of storage. You have to convince your fair price dealers to engage extra warehouses, and things are really very difficult. So how we will ensure it has to be seen. But let me tell you that, you know, food security has been achieved very nicely. And COVID pandemic was an example to demonstrate that India has successfully achieved food security in a state like Rajasthan, where we have even primitive tribe-like areas, which are very much delicate, which are very much endangered. So what I mean to say is that Rajasthan has been doing well in ensuring that the food grains reach to the last mile. What I see is that the diversification of food grain. Now people are talking that Rajasthan is the biggest producer of millet. We produce 50 lakh ton of bajra, of millet, every year. But there are no takers. And right now, as a food secretary, for last 15 days, I am attending a lot of meetings and deliberations that how to achieve the target of including millet as a food grain in our PDS system. And things are very difficult. The reason is that when you see towards high society, what I mean to say, if you see Amazon or Flipkart, if you see the grocery items there, you find that bajra or millet is a very fancy item now. They are selling the millet flour at very good prices. And the high society thinks that, you know, it is very good to take bajra millet rather than, you know, eating wheat, because there are many advocates of nutrition who are now opposing wheat as a good or healthy food grain. So there is an argument over that also. But how we will ensure it to everybody, this has to be seen, because I think wheat is the most convenient crop in this country to ensure food security so far. So what I'm facing is that, you know, I have been asked that, you know, 5 lakh farmers are agitating that, you know, their bajra should be purchased at MSP. And MSP is very high, and rate in market is very, you know, low. There is a big difference between the market price and the MSP price. So their demand is very genuine. But thing is that Government of India has a policy that you can procure what you can distribute in PDS. If you cannot distribute something in PDS, you should not procure it. So that is the policy of Government of India for last 6 years. So as a result, if I want to procure millet, I have to ensure that it is distributed to the general public. So when we conducted surveys in different villages and different clusters of Rajasthan, we found that people opposed it. They said that bajra is available in my own village. It is available at rupees 14 rupee per kg. So why should I leave my 20 rupee kg gehu and I should go to 14 rupee kg bajra? So then government had to decide whether it can please 5 lakh farmers and it can displease 4.4 crore ration holders. So there is a dilemma. There is a millet dilemma in our state, how to introduce millet in a way that it is acceptable to people in PDS. Can they accept 1 kg of bajra with 4 kg of wheat in their PDS allotment? So unless there is a consensus among the PDS holders and government, we cannot go on and purchase so much millet, because millet has a very limited shelf life also. All of us know very well. So that also has to be seen. When it comes to procuring rice, there are other issues, because rice milling has another aspect attached to it. Then if you want to make it fortified, you have to procure fortified rice from another facility. Then you have to blend it. You have to purchase blenders. So all this culture is coming up. For last 1 year, I can tell you, many people from other states are coming to Rajasthan to get the fortified rice, because some producers here are producing that blended fortified rice. And I hope that from in 15 districts, we are going to start. And in the next year, by March 22, I expect that all the children under midday meal and ICDS will get. I just want to have one last issue, and that is, there are three types of people, I think, in the society. One, who are already malnourished. Second, who are vulnerable to malnourished. And third, who presently are okay, but later on we cannot say. So the first people who are already malnourished, we run a lot of programs. Actually, Malnutrition Treatment Center under National Health Mission, because I have been Mission Director, National Health Mission for 4.5 years in Rajasthan. So I have a good idea how we are treating malnutrition. So malnutrition treatment centers, you have to bring your child there. You have to keep him there for 15 days. Then you give them some therapy. Results are not very encouraging. Parents are not ready to, you know, hold there for 15 days, courting that they are not getting any job or they are not getting any salaries for those 15 days. So many incentives were devised to keep them there. But still, there are issues. Then second is the people who can be vulnerable to malnutrition. So I think food fortification deals with this particular segment. Once you have got diabetes, you have to take some medicine and then you can start morning walk. And if you have got a good amount of diabetes, you can't say that I will be doing only morning walk. So by morning walk, you can control to some extent, but you have to take your medication. So similar way, once you are malnourished, you have to get a therapy or you have to get your complications attached with malnutrition treated, and then you can see. So food fortification looks like a very easy target, but the logistics in our country, the population coverage, the density, the transportation issues, the inefficiency of system, and many other factors, you know, are nightmare for us, and we have to deal with all of them. And what I will suggest, can we go for biofortification? But I suggest in long run, can we make a plan for India that by 2030 or maybe 2035, we can go for biofortification? If we can convert our crop capacity, our breeding of crops in such a way that the grain itself is having all the components, so you don't have to mix anything. So my wheat doesn't have to travel to some factory from my godown. Because first I have to procure from farmers, then I have to store it in my FSA godown. Then from FSA godown, I have to send it to producer. Then producer will blend something into it and he will churn it into flour. And then I have to again transport it. So many costs are involved. So can we think of long-term targets like biofortification? And by that time, we can go ahead with things like food fortification. And definitely, as an administrator, I'm telling that these are some of the issues which need to be dealt. And Rajasthan had successfully done, we have one CMAM program also, which I would like to quote. In 2016-17, we had done India's biggest CMAM exercise, where we had taken some 10,000 children and we fed them with the RUTF or say EDNS, whatever name you want to say, that energy dense supplementary food, and we found very good results, and more than 80% children were recovered from their SAM or MAM status to the normal status. But unfortunately, that study was never discussed anywhere. Unfortunately, nothing was published on that particular experiment. Based on that first experiment, another experiment was done in 2018-19 with again 10,000 children. It also was very successful. It incorporated many other factors also, like immunization and other related activities. But I just want to throw an idea that CMAM, as discussed, is not very much impossible for India. And I think that National Health Mission and ICDS system has to be integrated somewhere if we want to get some result there. So by running a good nutrition program, by tracking the nutrition status of the children, which now we are talking in 2.0, and thirdly, by having food fortification in certain communities, the biggest issue which will erupt will be who will bear the cost of fortification or the conversion. So that issue will again crop up, and many politicians are against this idea that cost should be passed on to the people. They say that we are giving wheat at 2 rupees per kg, and if conversion cost is more than 2 rupees per kg, we can't convince people that it is free. So again, if experts, if bureaucrats, if everybody is are deciding on this factor, we have to take politician on board also. So
some technical issue, I believe. Naveen ji, can you hear us? Yeah, please complete yourself, sir, because your connection was stopped for a moment.
I said that I have completed. I talked about integrating NHM and ICDS as far as malnutrition is concerned. I talked about deliberations on the issue of shifting of conversion cost to the PDS holders. There are some issues which need to be answered before we go ahead with large-scale food fortification of wheat flour. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your wonderful inaugural address. And in the technical session, I'm sure we would be able to have a detailed discussions on some of the points which you have already mentioned in your talk. Ladies and gentlemen, we are going straight for our technical session. And let me share it with you before I hand over the mic to the panel moderator, that is Ms. Deepthi Gulati, Nutrition and Public Health Specialist. Let me share with our audience that in this session, as I have shared that Ms. Deepthi Gulati is going to moderate, of course, we will have the opening remarks from Dr. C. Vasudevappa, Honorable Vice Chancellor, NIFTEM. Ms. Cheryl Salis, founder, Nurture Health Solutions, she will also be speaking in this session. Dr. Siddharth Wagulkar, Deputy Head, Nutrition and School Feeding Unit, WFP India. Dr. Simarov Nair, Professor, Department of Foods, Nutrition, the MS University of Baroda, a very inspiring university. I have been over there earlier. Dr. Sujit Ranjan, Public Health and Nutrition Specialist. Mr. Vivek Arora, Principal Lead, FFRC. And my colleague, Mallika Verma, Director, Agri and Food Processing Committee, PhD, CCI, will be giving the concluding remarks. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me request Ms. Deepthi Gulati to kindly moderate this session. And Ms. Mallika Verma, along with my colleague, Dipankar Khare, would be there in this session. Over to you, Ms. Gulati.
Thank you so much. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, ma'am, please go ahead.
Yes. So thank you so much for introducing all the panelists. And I also want to thank Mr. Naveen Jain for sharing his very valuable experiences. All I can just say, add to that is that food fortification, as he said, is doable even in the public funded programs. And in Rajasthan, we have done it in 2012 to 2014. And so you also, sir, also mentioned about passing on the cost of milling to the consumer. In Rajasthan, what we had done was we had done a, you know, dipstick survey wherein we studied, we contacted people in 13 districts and and we got the feedback that they were all willing to pay for milling of wheat flour and getting it fortified, because they all felt that if they were to get grains, they were to anyway pay for milling. So if it comes into fortified milled wheat flour, which is packed, then they're sure of quality as well as quantity. Now, so, and I have been very fortunate to have worked in Rajasthan with Sir, and I feel very, very honored to be on the same webinar with him and with Dr. Vasudevappa. So, Sir, back to you, Sir. And yes, may I please request you to share your presentation or your views on taking and scaling up staple food fortification.
Thank you, Madam Deepti Gulati. I think, you know, sorry, I had some throat problem. I don't know how it came, really. First time I experienced this. And otherwise, I usually never fumble in the, you know, the presentations. But anyway, so thanks once again for giving me this opportunity, and to the organizers especially. And I would like to just continue from where I stopped. I would say that, I know, it's a great initiative, especially to get into the fortification. I know now what is happening, of course, is a general fortification, which really happens at a grass level. Probably, I think we need to get into the fine-tuning of the entire process of fortification. That is very, very important. I know, of course, wheat is an easy product to fortify, in the sense, because we depend on wheat flour. That is the advantage with wheat. And wheat flour is the major, I would say, product or a commodity which is used for cooking food. So whereas in rice, there are some issues. Probably, of course, by, as was said by Mr. Navinji, I think it is more of biofortification if it can be done. That's a wonderful thing. I know ICR system has been working on that. But all the same, still they are not very successful to bring in all the required nutrients. That is the reason probably the fortification again becomes very imminent. And another thing, of course, apart from the flour, of course, if you are depending on the flour, rice flour, probably I think fortification is easier, like what is being done for the wheat. But unfortunately, rice is consumed as a grain. So that means you need to bring it back to the shape of a grain. That is the technology which is required, I would say, for rice fortification. If you are looking for a grain which where you can prepare the rice and cook it and then eat it and all that, then rice fortification becomes really tough. I know meeting the requirement of the larger mass is not that easy. The logistics involved, and I would say even the storage facilities involved and the proper storage is involved. All this, you know, matters very much. And another thing, of course, is that why rice, you know, wheat is really, you know, now, because I am seeing recent of the recent nature, the gluten content in the wheat flour, that is creating some problem. That is the reason probably many people are trying to say that I am gluten, you know, sensitive. So this is creating a problem. This is another area probably we need to look at, and how we can reduce the gluten content and also increase the efficiency or the quality of the wheat or wheat flour. That is something we need to really look at. And probably here, I would like to just make a mention. We, NIFTEM, in collaboration with, I would say, Hexagon and GAIN, we have established a center of excellence for food fortification at NIFTEM. Basically, I would say here, thanks to Hexagon for their real big involvement. Of course, Dr. Deepti Gulati has been a big support, and she will also be coming to NIFTEM as an industry chair to help us in all these activities. And one thing is that here we are looking for the edible oil or the milk and the wheat flour fortification at present. We want to expand it to even rice, because rice fortification involves quite a bit of investment. And probably thanks to, again, Hexagon for really agreeing even to put up the rice fortification unit also at NIFTEM. But the basic aim of this is, one thing is very clear here, we need to build capacity of the people, especially, I would say, the FBOs. So unless the food business operators are really made aware of the importance and the process that is involved in fortification, probably, I think, again, we will not be successful. I know resistance is there. especially to accept the fortified wheat flour or the fortified rice flour or the fortified rice per se, but the importance and the health benefits need to be taken up in a very big way with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, and probably even WCD is again another platform where we can really bring in a lot of advertisement, and that would really help. And these are the requirements for future. So we need to make it very clear. And I would say that this is going to become a very, very important thing, of course. I know we are planning a lot of, capacity building programs at NIFTAM. Could be a short-term structured paid training courses on edible oil, milk, wheat flour, and rice fortification. These are things which we are planning in a big way. Probably I wish that this center of excellence should keep busy for all the 365 days in a year, so that large number of people are brought in and their capacities are built, and even the industry visits can be organized, and that would really help them to really understand what is really fortification. Otherwise, as I said in the beginning, fortification is just not mixing some things and trying to say that we are fortified. No, it is not that. It has to be more science-based. I know we are even planning some customized programs also for students. In fact, students, especially those, there are more than 200 food science colleges in the country. So how do we build their capacity is also very important, because they are going to be the future as far as taking forward the science behind nutrition. That is very, very important. And even I would say some of the institutes, people also can come, the faculty, they need to be made aware. And for them, we will have some customized programs. Of course, that apart, I think our major target is for the industry. So the industry or the food business operators, they need to be trained, given a practical experience. Of course, we have all the facilities here in terms of pilot plants. Could be ready-to-eat products, could be even the bakery products, that is very important again. Fruits, vegetables, the milk, and the meat. I think in all these things, how we can look towards the fortification is very, very important. Probably we are setting up the fortification center amidst all these facilities. That means we have a direct access for every one of these facilities at NIFTAM, which can really help in improving the quality of the output or the product which is coming out. And that apart, I know another area where we really look forward is probably the micronutrient premixes, which is quality assured. So that is very important. Unless the quality or the ingredients are assured, probably again we will be cheating the nation, which should not happen. And we want quality, and we want safety, and also we want it to be accredited. That's where I think is very, very important. If we can do these things, and also probably I think we can really address some of these very important issues, I would say this is going to become very important. In the sense, why I tell this is, it is just not in isolation the fortification should be looked in. It could be the quality management system, the safety system, and even the biotechnological approaches or the nanotechnological approaches. These things become very important to make it a wholesome exercise where we can really dictate, or I would say this is what is the fact, the science behind all this fortification and things like that. Probably I wish, see, the center will definitely strive hard in this direction. I know Cheryl is also there with us, and she has been supporting. And absolutely, we will be very happy to share, to collaborate, to cooperate with anybody. I think lots of industries are really seriously interested now. Already the list is coming up now. When is the training starting and all that? Probably we will do it. Maybe we plan to start from the World Food Day. That is the 16th of this month itself. So let us hope that this is your facility, I would say, for all of you, I would say here, this is the facility for all of us. So we should use it. We should really get the science and understand the science behind it. I know we will be able to definitely take care of whoever comes here, and accepting the accommodation, which still, I would say, because of the COVID, we will not be able to do. All other things, I think absolutely there won't be any issue. So thank you very much. And once again, and this is a very important session. I wish the entire, I would say, the program, all the success. I know this is an eye-catching or a brain-catching or a mind-catching thing. We can always take it forward. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you so much, sir, for a very enlightening session. And I don't know why this is echoing. So can I?
Somebody has. There are two systems working simultaneously. Probably somebody has to switch it off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So all I just want to say is that we've had a very illuminating inaugural address, special address, wherein we have come to understand that, yes, there are challenges for fortification. But we are very happy that we have a very eminent panel discussion today, you know, which is, and we have very eminent panelists on the panel who would share with us, you know, how to make food fortification doable and how to take it forward. Yes, challenges are there. If challenges were not there, perhaps you would not even be having this webinar. Yeah. So we are all here collectively looking forward to making a difference. So I'll start with Cheryl Salas, because she's a nutrition expert with us. She's a clinical nutritionist, and she has been counseling a lot of you know, people with nutritional deficiencies, diabetes, etc.
Yeah.
So Cheryl, may I request you to share your views that how you can improve the quality of a diversified diet? Everyone says, yes, you must take a diversified diet. I fully endorse, fully agree. This is the best option. But can we add fortified wheat flour, fortified rice, and other fortified staples to this diversified diet to make it more enriched? So what kind of deficiencies you see in your clients, and what kind of advice you think is the best to give them, and whether fortification can make a difference? So I've already posed my questions to you, and may I request you to elaborate.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this. And it's wonderful being with this really esteemed panel. And we've had excellent learnings from each one of you. And I think the future forward is really very bright. And I hope that we are able to address the issue of malnutrition and hidden hunger in our country. And sir, just to tell you that I am there and always there to support, because I strongly believe in this, because we're definitely seeing that there's a huge gap in terms of nutrition. You know, one is, yes, affordability is a challenge, and therefore access to getting, you know, the food in terms of nutritious foods. And unfortunately, all the inexpensive foods are your unhealthy foods, which may not really provide you with the right nutrition. So I think definitely an attempt to try, and one is make people aware. Like you rightly said, I think it's very, very important that we even go down to schools and even nutrition colleges, you know, start, you know, training them so that when they come out, they are aware and they can now start counseling and educating and spreading awareness. Because honestly, this is not something that is covered in the college curriculum. And I think that's a very, very important point that you raised. And I think I will also take this onus to, as a faculty in many institutions, to make sure that I discuss this point with all our students. And yes, we are definitely seeing, one is, yes, you know, the hidden hunger, malnutrition in people who are not affording or do not have access. But also what is emerging now is that even the people who can afford, and the elite population, or even the people from the higher socioeconomic class, because there's so much of misinformation and misconceptions. And a lot of them are going on to diets or embarking on such diets, which are eliminating food groups. And a lot of food groups get eliminated. And I'm sure each one of you is aware that, you know, certain kinds of diets are becoming very popular because you're all looking for short fix, quick fix approaches. And we have no patience to do it the right way. And we want something which is quick. And unfortunately, we have a lot of self-proclaimed experts who are there, who are not really qualified, but giving out advice, you know, and without really, and they don't care, because it's all about them earning money, becoming rich or cash rich, without caring as to what are going to be the long-term consequences. And unfortunately, this is even affecting our children today, because, you know, parents are getting convinced it's such kind of information. And they are, I've seen a lot of people giving up milk completely, wheat completely, because there's so much of misconceptions. And, you know, it's very difficult for us to convince them. And there is definitely a lack in terms of micronutrients and protein deficiency. I think we're all aware. And, you know, we know that even when we are consuming protein, especially when we take our dietary recalls, we see one is that protein deficiency is there, but also quality of protein.
Yeah, right.
And I think the What India Eats report, as well as the STAT study, all of them have alluded to the fact that, yes, we are protein deficient, and also the kind of protein, the quality is important. And that's where the role of fortification, nutraceuticals becomes extremely important. And therefore, I think we have to plan a very individualized plan. Iron deficiency anemia, like I was discussing with Dipti ma'am even the last time, that, you know, when we did a study with young adolescents and young adults in the age group of 16 to 25, we saw anemia to the tune of around 57%. And that is actually what is even documented. And these were students coming from good households. So it was not really, people who are not affording. So good households, good colleges, and we're seeing these numbers. So definitely there is a gap and fortification and making sure that we're also, when we're trying to give nutrition advice, I think we've heard about millets and the different kinds of cereals. So while we're trying to plug the nutrition gap with fortification, but also with that, trying to correct the kind of, eating patterns. And I think it's time to reinforce traditional eating food habits. Okay. Because right from fermentation and the whole farm to fork, I think, approach is what we really need to educate people about. And that is what we've been doing, not only with students at schools, but also at corporates, because people don't understand the kind of nutrition they lose, even right from the food they source to how they wash the food to right from cooking to storing. I think there is nutrition loss happening there. So all these are kind of things that we would like to emphasize on. And I think very important as a nutritionist, I think that is another role that I would play, is also emphasize on the importance of buying fortified, food produce when we are buying wheat or buying rice. And, rice, yes, now it's recent. I think there was a very good publication that came up in the Nutrients Journal also. And I would encourage each one of you to read it. It's a very recent publication on food fortification. And I think even the government of India, I think the Prime Minister is trying to do a lot of efforts, like the Nutrition Month and the whole focus on, portion se paude. Paude se portion. So trying to get nutrition and, kitchen garden. I think the whole concept, again, is very, very simple. So all these simple approaches in terms of improving nutrient density and diet diversity is definitely key. And we will, as nutritionists, we have a big role to play here. And, because we are the direct connect with the clients, with the patients, with the, population at large. And I think education and making them aware is very important. Another point that I want to highlight here is, a lot of people today are moving on to becoming vegan. So veganism is catching up as a way of life. And though it's not a wrong thing, it's something that if you do it right, it's fine. But there can be certain nutritional deficiencies that arise out of these diets. For example, B12 deficiency. And another thing that we see commonly is that people are now opting for salts, like pink salts. And, these colored salts are getting very popular. And I think there was a very good, I think celebrities also endorsed these kind of diets. But I think it was a very responsible part on Sonam Kapoor, where she actually came out. I don't know how many of you actually saw it, but she came out on social media and said that, I have been following veganism and I have been diagnosed with iodine deficiency. And therefore, I would request you that when you're looking at salt, try and use iodized salt, because I was not doing it. And my iodine levels have really gone down. I think that is a very, very important role that a celebrity or an influencer plays. So I think these are a few things that I would like to, highlight and maybe take onus and responsibility to try and do my bit and contribute.
Thank you so much, Cheryl, for giving a very lucid views on food fortification and how to make food safe and how to avoid nutritional deficiencies. Yes, we see a lot of fads these days, vegan diets and gluten-free diets and so on and so forth. I can only assure you with sufficient confidence, with scientific background, that gluten allergies are not really a big problem in India at all. And if there are a few people who have these issues, they can be sorted out. But those numbers are very few. And wheat flour and wheat grain is a very, very healthy ingredient or a staple to consume. Secondly, in vegan, you avoid milk, which again is a very critical and an excellent source of protein and hence must be consumed. And so this is how I would like to say that it is very responsible. It is our own responsibility to ensure that we spread the message of good nutrition with responsibility and not let people indulge in fantasies and so on and so forth. So thank you so much. Now I would like to invite Siddharth Vagulkar, who is a deputy head with WFP. And I would like him to share with us you know, why industry should be encouraged and involved in, you know, production of fortified foods, which are not just the staple foods, but also the processed foods. In addition, because we've had some discussions on rice fortification, I would request Siddharth to even touch upon the ease of fortifying rice, because he represents WFP, and WFP, PATH, and Nutrition International. They have been working in the area of rice fortification for a long time. PATH started it in India. WFP and I have joined, and they are very successfully doing fortified rice in PDS also, and a school feeding program. So over to Siddharth for your wisdom advice on how industry should be involved and how PDS can provide fortified rice. Over to you.
I have just a few slides and I'll just brush through it. And thanks for the PhD CCI for inviting us to be a part of these discussions. And I'll not try and repeat what my previous speakers have spoken about. So deep dive directly into the topic. I mean, we know all about it, that anemia is widely prevalent and it's prevalent across the different economic sections of the society. These are different measures, so I'll skip on that because the previous speakers have spoken about it. Okay. So since the topic is more about the private sector and the industry, how the food industry could be involved into it, so there's a case study which I would like to share with you. And this is from the one of the very successful stories from the Britannia industry or the Britannia fortified biscuits. It was very popularly known as the creative capitalism by Bill Gates. Basically, this case study is about how Britannia introduced fortified biscuits into the Indian markets and how they were able to improve the micronutrient levels or even hemoglobin levels amongst the masses. As you would see on the screen here, there were two supply chains that are shown here. So one is the commercial supply chain where, I mean, it's Britannia supplied their own biscuits through a commercial supply chain to their own distributors, outlets, and to the consumers. It was fortified with iron. Likewise, they also developed another biscuit or another product which was fortified with slightly higher levels of iron. And it was supplied to NGOs or say even as part of their CSR under the different public sector schemes or the food safety net schemes that exist. The key strategies that Britannia or, you know, this particular company adopted in this particular case was that we all know that biscuits was a very popular food item that is consumed by people all across. So why not use or why not leverage the demand for biscuits as a carrier for micronutrients? Why not use them as a carrier for micronutrients? Secondly, also talking about the affordability, we all have talked about that fortification is very cost effective. And so likewise, in this case, you would see that it was priced at around 3 rupees per packet of the fortified biscuits. So again, it was easily affordable by all people across the sections of the society. Likewise, the other strategy that they adopted was selective targeting. I mean, they placed the image of a tiger on the product. I mean, tiger signifies strength, tiger signifies power. And likewise, I mean, children were attracted to that sort of a packaging as well. So the more children consumed it, and it also led to improvement in their levels of hemoglobin as well. And likewise, they had the existing technology, had the production capacity. So they just leveraged the existing technology and production capacity to produce these fortified biscuits. There was no additional changes that were required. There was an independent evaluation done for the study. And what was found out that this trial or this particular example led to increment in the blood hemoglobin levels, especially when the biscuits were consumed regularly for a period of about 140 to 150 days. So you would say that almost half a yearly period, which was, or 5 months of the year, which was taken as a time period. If you look at the incremental cost, which was there in this particular case, it was around 6 paise per kilogram of the biscuit. And it was not necessarily passed on to the consumers. It was, in fact, there was no need felt to pass on to the consumers. These guys did it simply by optimizing their own production and supply chain. So there was no need, in fact, to also go till the consumers there. There are numerous cases or examples of industry partners already fortifying products, be it fortified oil, be it fortified rice, wheat flour, milk, and salt. And these are some of these. What are the key strengths or the key strengths in this entire or support that you would see for the private sector is that nowadays consumers are very health conscious and they would want to have more benefits or say more nutrition from the product that they're consuming. So that is where fortified foods come in as an advantage. Likewise, they're a value added product or they give you more, offer you more value for your money. I mean, it's the same amount of money, but then you're getting additional benefits in terms of the nutrition. Also in terms of the private sector, they have a additional responsibility or, you know, they can have the outreach to people. I mean, the public sector schemes can reach out to a limited number of people, only the vulnerable sections of the society or people who are most needy. But then private sector can reach out across the sections of the society. So that way the private sector holds the strength to this. The weakness that I see in the system is that very few consumers are aware about the benefits of fortified foods. So there definitely needs to be action on increasing the awareness regarding fortified foods. And in terms of the opportunities for private sector or say the favorable environment, there is regulatory environment which is favorable, especially from support from FSSAI, be it standards for processed commodities or the other food commodities which are existing. So that way we have supportive environment for the private sector there. And this is one line which I wanted to talk about since we recently had Gandhi Jayanti, very recently. So this is what Mahatma Gandhi had commented upon, is that whilst it is true that man cannot live without air and water, the only thing that nourishes the body is food. Hence saying that food is life. So, I mean, of course, fortified food has the potential that it can add that value add, or it can give you the additional nutrients required for the body and definitely nourish the body as required. To come upon rice fortification, I think, thanks Deepti ji for asking this question. And I mean, since WFP has been working on this issue over the last decade or so, we've been implementing pilots all across the country. And if you would see that fortification of rice through PDS is not a difficult task. In fact, it is very, I would say that it's a very cost-effective measure as well. And plus it can be easily done. I'll just share you what is fortified rice all about, and then you may itself understand the process as well. So in fortified rice, what we have is basically, as my previous speakers spoke about, that while rice is being milled or it's being polished, so there's a lot of vitamins and minerals which are lost in the process. So as the vitamins and minerals are lost in the process, the rice which you commonly get across in the markets or the people which, I mean, the rice which we consume is the milled rice which we get. In rice fortification, what is done is that we have, we basically add fortified rice kernels to the regular rice in the ratio of 1:100. And fortified rice kernels are nothing but it basically are rice grains with added vitamins and minerals. I mean, they are prepared from rice flour, and you can see from the diagram itself that they're prepared from broken rice and head rice. And you just have the added vitamins and minerals. So once these are blended with regular rice in the ratio of 1:100, it gives you fortified rice. Why I'm saying that fortification of rice through PDS is simple, because we already have rice millers who are empaneled with the Food Corporation of India and the different state bodies. The rice millers just have to procure the FRKs, which are easily available in the market. There are multiple suppliers of FRK. As of now, we have about more than 50 plus suppliers of FRKs in the market. The rice millers have to procure the FRKs, which are ready-made, and then blend it at their own level with help of a blender help of a blending machine. Basically, in the mix in the ratio of 1:100. So that way, the FCI, the Food Corporation of India, is currently adopting the same model. And as Naveen sir also mentioned, that by early 2022, we might also start with distribution of fortified rice to PDS, ICDS, and MDM in select states through FCI. In case there are any further queries, definitely I would like to answer that. And over from my end. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Siddharth, for addressing both the issues which are critical, one about the industry. And I'm very happy that you talked about the challenges and the opportunities and the strengths of food industry in scaling up food fortification and bringing out fortified food products. I really want to go back in the memory to say that when I was with WFP, we started with the, fortified biscuits of Britannia, that Iron Shakti biscuits. And it was an amazing hit because children used to walk to the schools from long distances, and the first thing that they got was a packet of fortified biscuits. And so it assuaged the hunger, both for calories as well as for micronutrients. And then, of course, was the midday meal that was given. So thank you for taking me down the memory lane. And of course, it showed very good results in terms of improved anemia levels. I also wish to, thank you for sharing with us and allaying the fears with respect to fortified rice, because I know NI, WFP, and as well as PATH, you are doing a lot of work on mainstreaming fortified rice into the PDS very successfully. So we wish you all the best, and thank you for sharing, and thank you for reassuring that rice fortification is doable, just as VC sir also said that wheat flour fortification is also very doable. So we have a responsible industry to move forward on that. Now, may I please request Ms. Dr. Srimavo Nair, who has also been the, on panel of FSSAI for setting out the standards for staple food fortification. And I would like to request her to talk about the regulatory support and an enabling environment that exists for staple food fortification. So over to Dr. Srimavo Nair.
Good afternoon, warm welcome to everybody. This is from Varudra. Respected delegates, I am all invited participants. This is a great opportunity to share. I'm thankful to PHDCCI and Hexagon and Vikiman for inviting me. What we have looked into before we set the standards for India was, like any country, how the WHO and the FAO supports is to look and address the malnutrition status. So while looking at malnutrition status, it was found that our country needed a very urgent and critical call to address the levels of malnutrition, irrespective of the age, which is coming across right from children from 6 months to the elderly. We had a population who is malnourished. Also, we have iron deficiency anemia, which was coexisting. There are multiple micronutrient deficiencies which also coexist. And at this juncture, it was looked into by the FAO to give the mandate and to give the support. And that's how the whole exercise started. So WHO and FAO had advised the government of India to start this process. That's how the process and decision for fortifying the major staples came into the existence. So this was the first mandate which was rolled out to have a consensus, and therefore across the board the scientific panel was constituted, and we had various people coming from all walks of life as scientists who were working in the fortification process, also from government bodies and NGOs representing the whole system. So that's how the whole process started. While setting up the standards, we also looked into the consensus where there is a rice eating population, there is a wheat eating population. These are the major staples which we are coming across. So looking into that, a plate was designed by which there would be talk about 5 to 10 grams of salt added, oil added into the food. A person taking, say, 100 to 150 grams of rice may consume, say, 2 rotis. Or if a person is eating chapatis in their diet, then it will say 3 chapatis and then a little bit of rice. Even though they would take this whole plate of fortified food, this was meeting only 1/3 of the requirement of the intakes. rest of the two-thirds, we always have advised that the locally grown dietary habits have to be practiced, and vegetables and fruits and other grains which are locally available should be taken into the system. So putting all these things together, the fortification which was kept in mind is not the sole solution which was addressing, but to address malnutrition, we need multiple micronutrients as a physiological aspect to absorb all the vitamins, and when it goes through food per se, it absorbs better. Over to Deepthina.
Thank you so much, Siri, for sharing with us how the standards are evolved. One thing I would like to ask is that a lot of people and a lot of news articles are there which say that if multiple foods are fortified specifically with iron, it can lead to toxicity. And you being on the scientific panel, I'm sure you can share with us that these are the kind of things that I'm sure scientific panel would have taken into consideration. And please share with us your views and about can fortification ever lead to toxicity, even if multiple food products are fortified. Over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. I want to reassure this back to everybody. Before we had set this whole process, we had sat with all the calculations based on the recommendations given by the WHO and FAO for our country, number one. After looking into that, as I said, we also looked into the process of having multiple micronutrients coming through the food. So when we were giving the staples of rice and wheat, as I said, we also added the iron, which is coming from the salt also, which is only at 800 to 1100 ppm. Now, that is not, nobody is going to exceed the cost of those fortification because it's not so easy said and done with cost. So that is also in their limit. And the wheat also is a very minute quantity, which is coming to 1.25 milligrams when you are talking of. And that is never going to exceed any level of toxicity which is coming. If we were to say like that, then 60 mg elemental iron, which is being given as iron folic acid, that would have definitely come into the picture. Though we are talking of so only say 100 tablets for a pregnant lady. So keeping all that in mind, whether it was transport of iron from the mother to the fetus and the fetus taking it to the second trimester or the first trimester, despite that, we are talking of iron getting released only as and when required. It is completely encapsulated iron, and it will release only as per the proportion which is coming and required. So the intestinal receptors would activate or get activated only when there is a requirement. It's not going to just the iron is available in the system and it is going to come. Since it is an encapsulated form, it will not get released unless and until it is needed, number one. Number two, in wheat or whether it is in salt, I just now spoke how the technology would be in salt. Even in the wheat, when it is going to be digested, partial digestion starts when the acids in the stomach is being released. Even then, even it is to be absorbed, it will be absorbed as per proportional requirement of the intestine, as per the person's requirement and the need. So put together all this, we calculate, we recalculated this, and there are elderly scientists also in the panel, and they definitely said I and Dr. Madhavan Nair were the ones who calculated. So the other two members in the working group said, we want you to recalculate back from the top to the bottom. So we did the reverse order calculations. We checked with everything and we made it sure that we are not going above the upper tolerable limits. We designed this with very clear consensus of a sedentary man, a working man, a sedentary woman, a working woman, a pregnant lady, a small child of 5 years. So these were the people and the activities taken into consideration before finalizing the standard. Once that was said, we reversely did suppose all these put together, is it coming to any toxic levels? We also know that it can cause vitaminosis and therefore some issues were raised by some amount of people in the system. So we reworked on this, and after coming to the consensus, we even have advised 10% overages for the standards even at present, which we have put. So if we have put 10% overages allowing certain limitations, then where is the question of the toxicity coming?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing your views that how FSSAI has taken all care. And yes, I do agree that the tolerable upper limit is about 45 milligrams. And with all sources, it does not even reach 20% of the tolerable upper limit. So as I understand, fortification of my different staple foods, different processed foods with multiple micronutrients, even when consumed in combination, is absolutely safe. And here, friends, I would also like to share that in Rajasthan, when we were doing fortified, we were providing fortified wheat flour through the PDS during 2012 to 2015. The National Family Health Survey was conducted in 2015 and report released in 2016. And this National Family Health Survey was conducted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And if you would see the data of Government of India and the data of Government of Rajasthan, that the fact sheet of Rajasthan and fact sheet of India, you would find that though anemia levels were about 50 to 53% in at the all India level, at the Rajasthan level, the anemia levels were 46%. And that was perhaps due to the fortification of wheat flour that was provided through the PDS. So as I would like to second Dr. Sribhavan Nair, that fortification works. Now, I would like to invite our next speaker, which is Mr. Vivek Arora from FFRC FSSAI. And since he has been working with FFRC for a long time, and he's a dairy technologist also. So I would like him to discuss the role of FFRC in supporting fortification and creating public awareness. Over to you, Vivek.
Thank you, Deepti ji, and good afternoon, everyone.
We have lost his voice.
Vivek, we can't hear you. Vivek, are you there? I think we lost Vivek. So if everyone agrees, then we can have Vivek Arora talking about the role of FFRC a little later. And since I can see Dr. Sujit Ranjan, I would like to utilize this time to get Dr. Sujit Ranjan on board. And he has been the executive director for the Coalition for Food and Nutrition Security. And he's the icon who speaks on public-private partnerships for improving nutritional outcomes. And we would like to request him to share his views on how to build up these partnerships, how to scale up these partnerships so that everyone enjoys the nutritional benefit. Over to you, Sujit.
Yeah, thank you very much, Deepti ji, and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for having me today in this program. And I was listening all the inspiring words from all these speakers. And so far as public-private partnership is concerned, it's very close to my heart. And for last several years,
years, we are trying to promote this. And we know this fact very well that India has the highest level of public investment in food and nutrition security of any country through its public funded programs. And the right of food and nutrition is in its our constitution. So that's the part of our constitution. And at the same time, we know this fact very well that India's greatest national treasure is our children, our adolescent, our people. But the micronutrient deficiencies or the hidden hunger and the negative consequences of a diet like lacking in essential vitamins and minerals, stress elements, continue to pose the significant public health problem in our community, in our population. This hidden hunger is more prevalent in our vulnerable population, including women of reproductive health and the young children and adolescents. And it has taken a magnitude of a silent emergency. So now where is the, what is the solution? There are many solutions and we talked about all the speakers we're talking about because we have the policies, we have the programs and we have been the earliest starter. So why I'm saying earliest starter, India has been one of the earliest countries to start the national vitamin A supplementation program, national level iron supplementation program for women and children and community nutrition program in the form of ICDS, that is the Anganwadi Center. And now we are for how to bring all the players together, how to leverage the expertise of our private players. So the public-private partnership is one of the strategies to enable and promote nutrition. So that's the, in last, I can, all of us are part of that in last decade, it has taken over a decade to move from problem recognition and full scale policy action. So number one, we have recognized that yes, malnutrition is a problem, food security and is a problem, the food is a problem, like how to align. We agree on the drivers who can play an important role. We agree on the solutions that how the public-private partnership fortification can play an important role and the other role of public-private partnership. We also acted, like act the policy instruments, invest in effective programs, and also we learn that how to monitor, how to recalibrate. So these are the strength we are having. And so far as the public-private partnership is concerned, we know in our country, it has been a success in other areas such as infrastructure, energy, education, urban development, even tourism and more. But in the recent past, we have acknowledged that it can be a powerful to India's malnutrition challenge. Public-private partnership in nutrition sector, the potential to resolve the issues and ensure good nutrition inclusion for the community. So, and I was part of the journey, I strongly believe that public-private partnership is benefiting everyone. And today, there is a time like when we can make it reality in so many areas where we talked about and how that will be part of our policy recommendations and how that will be part of our policy suggestions to the policymakers. Like number one, the food system with involvement with almost all aspects of products, like the production, processing, fortification, distribution, consumption, then a big built the data culture. They engage the communities in a more effective manner to know about their preferences, know about their attitude, know what they want and how we can reach out to them. To engage the relevant key actors in nutrition promotion and to promote NutriGarden for promoting diet diversity as well as food safety. And to use information technology that can be leveraged on ensuring many services. So these are the opportunities we have seen and we have utilized the services. And if you can reform our public-private partnership now, it creates an opportunity to ripple effect in the areas of like even the education, health, water and sanitation. And we can get the expertise, affordability and the technology. So these are the, like there is a growing recognition that complex and multidimensional issues of malnutrition, such as double burden of malnutrition and requires cross-sectoral and holistic approaches. So here, this is the public-private partnership is the solution and we are using it. And even the state government and central government is also like taking it in a very positive manner. I can understand government must remain in the driver's seat as the legislative and a standard setting body, whilst convening and pulling together all the resources, the knowledge, the expertise, and the different stakeholders. And a number of initiatives involved in private sector have made valuable contribution in improving nutrition outcomes through food fortification, improved labeling standards, restriction on marketing and distribution to the vulnerable groups. I'm very happy to share some of my learnings like working very closely with sustainable development goal especially the SDG Assam, where we are very much involved in the multi-sectoral nutrition plan. And we identified that multi-sectoral is a complex and multi-dimensional issues, how to bring the other players together. So that's the learning I'm having, and I'm trying to, maybe if the time permits, I will be very happy to share the learnings that how the different line departments, different important players, private players, the public sectors, how they can come together and can prepare a plan, and how the state government and the district administration is taking the driving seat to take this agenda forward. So I strongly believe that public-private partnership, the engagement of the public-private, our private players for improving the nutrition, this is the time, like the learning which you are having, and COVID has given an excellent opportunity to learn all those things and how to take it forward. So I'm very much optimistic to take it forward for not only for fortification, rather the other aspects of addressing the nutrition. Thank you very much, Dipti.
Thank you so much, Sujit ji, for beautifully explaining how the public-private partnership is one of the strategic enablers to promote nutrition. And of course, you know, we have a little paucity of time. So towards the end, if you would have time, you would definitely want to you to share your experiences. And I'm also very grateful that you mentioned how efficiently multi-sectoral approaches are the key to tackle malnutrition, specifically micronutrient malnutrition in India and in children. And we are very happy to see Mr. Vivek Arora back. So Vivek, over to you. And could you please share with us how FFRC is supporting for scaling up food fortification, staple food fortification? And what is the role?
Thank you, Dipti ji.
Over to
you. Yeah, thank you, Dipti ji. My apologies for the power connection and the internet. Losing the internet. I would like to share a couple of slides to just set the context what FFRC is doing. And then if you have any specific queries, then you can ask me. Also, I would say how the standards were set. And then Dr. Sujit, to explain us the role of the public-private partnerships, because at FFRC, we are sitting somewhere in between. We're sitting with the government, engaging with the partners. So the role that we are playing, let's see in detail what role FFRC is playing.
Vivek, I think you are still having a big challenge about
his voice is breaking off.
Yes. Your voice is breaking, we can't hear you. So if you can present it yourself or else.
Tell me when.
if you allow, even we can present that on your behalf.
I have a slow connection.
Vivek ji, I'm sorry, ma'am Gulati. If Vivek ji can just switch off his video, I think his bandwidth will improve.
Sure. So Vivek, can you switch off your video? I think there is a big challenge. So if PhD CCI can, you know, run his slides, I can do the presentation on role of FFRC to support fortification. Vivek, can you switch off your video?
I can play his video. I mean the presentation.
So if you can,
Dipanka, you can share your screen.
Yeah, I'll just share it. Just give me a second. Please tell me if you can see that.
Yes, we can see it. So do I present or do we wait for Vivek? Dipankar, I need your advice on that.
Dipankar, if you can call, I don't think we can hear Mr. Vivek Arora.
Yes, we can hear him properly. So I think, ma'am, you should go ahead, Deepthi, ma'am.
Okay, then can you get onto the next slide, please? This is the food fortification journey in India. We started in 1953 with mandatory fortification of Vanaspati. And today, we are also having a legislation or a recommendation and standards on processed foods fortification. Next slide, please. The role of FFRC is very, very critical and important in scaling up food fortification in India because FFRC provides the technical support and documentation support to FSSAI to set up a dedicated hub, which is called the Food Fortification Resource Center. It helps the government in reviewing the standards, collating information from the consumers and other populations on what are their views and bring it to the notice of the scientific panel, which then takes a review and clarifies. FFRC was also the key stakeholder which created the Plus F logo, because Plus F logo denotes that this is a adequately, appropriately fortified staple based on the standards enumerated by FSSAI. So the Plus F logo, which is critical, was the contribution of FFRC. Then the second important role that FFRC plays is in advocacy, both with the industry and with the state governments through consultations. It facilitates food fortification in both open market as well as in the state government. It also ensures the supply of fortified food products in the open market by supporting the industry in overcoming any challenges that may be there. And it helps the industry to link up with the government's food safety net programs so that the state governments can mainstream and honor the request of the Ministry of Women and Child Development as well as Ministry of Education that only fortified staples like wheat flour, rice, oil and milk, and double fortified salt should be used in the public funded program. So it ensures the supply by linking the industry with the government food safety net programs. FFRC also creates a demand for fortified foods by building consumer awareness. If you would go to the...
I'm sorry to bother you. I think Vivek ji is raising his hand. So I think he's back.
Okay. So, I'm back. I'm back if you...
Vivek, you are still very musical.
We can't hear you, Vivek.
Loud, then I'll tell you, not a problem.
I think Vivek is still very musical, so I'll get on with the prose. So, FFRC creates demand by building consumer awareness. It has many videos with the influencers that have been placed on the FFRC FSSAI website, as well as played on the national media. It has also roped in the commercial channels, the FM radios, to create awareness about the fortified food products. Then another important thing that FFRC does is provides training to the food safety officers, not just for doing the audits of the fortified food products, but also sensitizing them so that they can encourage the food industry in their state to adopt food fortification. These food safety officers, they engage with the labs, the food industry, as also with the MSMEs and the development sector partners to scale up and promote food fortification. Again, FFRC also plays a very important role in monitoring and evaluation, and it randomly takes up these samples of fortified food products from the industry, from the market, and also from the food safety net programs to see whether they are compliant with the articulated standards or not. And in case there is any compliance issue, it helps the industry to undergo another training so that it can do a good job of appropriate and adequate fortification of the staples that the industry is producing. Next slide, please. Deepankar, next slide. Yes. The key achievements and what FFRC has done to scale up staple food fortification is that it released the draft standards in 2016, which invited comments from the common people, academia, research scholars, which were then incorporated, reviewed, and gazetted in 2018. It introduced the Plus F logo. It launched a dedicated website for food fortification with a Plus F logo endorsement. It provides online training for the food safety officers, and over 2,100 food safety officers have been trained and certified. It develops technical manuals, training materials, books, and publications in partnership with the development sector partners who have been working in the area of food fortification. It provides extensive consumer awareness through public engagement, and it also engages social and mass media, and it organizes lots of activities. We had a very good cyclothon 2 years back when food fortification was given a very, very prominent window to create awareness. And of course, it develops the standard operating procedures for fortification, inter-lab comparisons, so that all the fortified food that comes to the public is quality assured, and it goes through the proper quality assurance and quality control protocols. So these have been basically the key achievements of FFRC. Next slide, please, which shows the current status of food fortification in the open market. And as you can see, 157 fortified food products are available across India. Next slide, please. The way forward, it is supporting what has been already discussed. It supports. Next, please. Thank you so much. And fortified food products are the enriched foods. So let's enrich foods and enrich lives. Thank you so much, Vivek, for developing these PowerPoint presentations, these slides. And I was able to run through not so badly because I have been a part of the FFRC for over 2 years. So with this,
we conclude with the very good, very meaningful discussions with the eminent panelists. Now over to Deepankar. If you have a few questions from the participants, may I request you, Deepankar, to read out so that we can request our panelists to respond to.
So I think I've got one question is that for the someone asked that for the millets also the same issues will be there, which are related to fortification of floor. So how to overcome that?
Millets is a different issue because millets have a limited shelf life. They need to be processed. As it is now, the standards that have been articulated are for rice and wheat flour. Once the millets start getting mainstreamed, and millets are a very rich source, natural source of micronutrients also. Once millets start getting mainstreamed into the public funded programs, I'm sure FSSAI would review and issue out the standards. But yes, millets are a very good source of micronutrients. But mainstreaming millets into the public funded programs remains a little bit of a challenge, unless until sourced locally, cooked locally, served locally. So that is something that I can respond. If there is anyone else from the panel who would like to respond, you're free to answer.
Ma'am, I would like to respond. There was a concern brought this much earlier also in 2019. And the reason at that point of time, we looked into the cost of fortification for millets. The only issue remained was the interference of other phytoestrogens which come into the millets. And the millets have got a very high amount of other phytoestrogens. No doubt they are iron rich, and everything is great about the millets. Personally asking, I also consume Bajra when we are in Gujarat. So the absorption also is really, really good. But looking into the multiple diets which we consume, there are some interferences which happen. Now, somebody has to work out and give a scientific study on that, then these things would come out much clearer.
Thank you so much for clarifying, and I'm sure this question has been answered. If there are no questions, we can request Madam
sir is also raising his hand.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, sir. I think you know it's Madam Nair, I think raised a very valid point. I know millets are supposed to be nutri cereals. They are rich in one is of course calcium and second is iron, and that apart maybe the analysis part as she said rightly, especially the millet flour processing which we have forgotten, and especially fortification we have forgotten in that area. How do we bring in quality into it? I think that would be really required, maybe to make it more accessible and also tasty. These two issues need to be looked at because millets are disliked by the younger generation because of the taste. Some small odor or things like that, which they do not like. So that's where we need to bring in that quality improvement on one side and fortification on the other side. As she said rightly, probably, I think, you know, NIFTEM would be very much interested now to work on this and in collaboration with, of course, Hexagon and GAIN, and probably come up with the scientific, you know, I would say the report. This is very important. And this, I think, is a neglected area, though we have been claiming that it's a nutri-cereal and we have forgotten about it. In the sense, it is just not the promotion part of it. How do we promote it further in a much better way? Probably with a good, I would say, appearance, good taste, and good biodigestibility, and all those issues. If that can be worked out, I think it would be really good. I wish this a very good area to take it forward.
Is there any other question or any other comment?
Yes, ma'am. There is a question. Someone asked that.
Yeah.
What are the level of micronutrient for fortified rice kernel? Someone asked this question.
The micronutrient levels for fortification of rice are absolutely similar to those for wheat flour. They're all on the FFRC FSSAI website. And the gazette notification is there. Please look up and you would get the answers.
Yeah.
Ma'am, if somebody wants to know, this ride from 14.25 mg to 42.5 mg, that the highest level which you can go, and depends. So it depends on the level of the salt which is being used. So if it is ferrous citrate, ferrous lactate, ferrous sulfate, then pyrophosphate. Yeah. If it is sodium EDTA, it is 14 mg to 21.25 mg.
Yes.
Yeah.
In the,
yes.
Ma'am, I just wanted to add in here, because I think they were asking about the FRK standards. So per se, you have standards for fortified rice. For FRK, when you are developing the FRK, you need to factor in the processing, I mean the production losses as well as the storage losses. So you'll have to add in a bit of overages. And that is something which you can see, I mean, it's based on your experience of developing FRKs and all. So based on that, you can factor in some of, there are some guidance production, I mean, overages and storage recipes, which are there available. And you can also refer the TOR, which is developed by the, on fortified rice kernel, which is developed by FSSAI, FFRC as well. And there is one in development by BIS as well.
Yeah,
so
right.
Surely that will be available with you as well.
Here I would like to add that, you know, there is a website ffrc.fssai.gov.in. You please visit there. You have all the resource material available regarding fortification for all the staples. So you can visit this website and you can get the information.
That is.
And I hope now I am audible. I am on a different.
Yes, you are now.
Yes. Yes.
And my apologies for the mix-up.
The tech glitches made you to be away.
No problem. You created a very great presentation, Mr. Vivek. So moving ahead, I don't think so.
Thank you for, you know, taking that presentation. I know you are very well aware of what is happening at FFRC. So you were the right person to, you know, carry it forward. So thank you for taking it forward.
Pleasure.
Ma'am, I think I'll just answer one question if you allow me. There was just one question I see in the chat box. It talks about in rice fortification, which is externally, which is added externally, not extruded type of fortification, it gets washed away. So how is the purpose served? So basically, to answer your question, the FRKs that are added to fortified rice or to prepare fortified rice, these FRKs are extruded kernels. So that is why when you wash away, when you, in India, we have a habit of washing our rice. So even if you wash away, these micronutrients will not be washed away with water. And when you cook the fortified rice, they will be intact. And in fact, there are limited cooking losses or something, or even the property of the kernel is such that it will cook like normal rice.
Correct.
So hope to answer
Thank
your
you
question.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Very good.
Thank you so much, Siddharth, for clarifying. Because I can also add on one thing, that whenever the standards are made, that taking into consideration our process of cooking oil. So even when oil is fortified, we know that we use the oil for frying. So even after three times frying, after that oil is not even good for consumption. Even after three times frying, the loss of micronutrients is very minimal, and that is covered by the overages. So the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, the scientific panel, takes into consideration our eating habits and our cooking habits and the kind of food that we eat before finalizing the standard. Thank you, Siddharth, for clarifying. So over to you, Mallika ji, for your summation and concluding remarks.
Thank you, Ms. Gulati. It is a pleasure to be present here on behalf of PhD Chamber and expressing our gratitude to all our eminent panelists since the beginning of the session. So my special thanks to, first of all, Sri Naveen Jain, Secretary, Department of Food, Civil Supplies and Consumer Affairs, Government of Rajasthan, for having joined this session and sharing his views and the initiatives by the Rajasthan government. My special thanks to Dr. Chindi Vasudevappa, Honorable Vice Chancellor of NIFTIM. He has always been very supportive of PhD CCI initiatives. And thank you, sir, for sharing the initiatives by NIFTIM towards malnutrition eradication and the Center of Excellence set up with the help of.
Yes, I am. Give me 5 minutes. I will call you back.
Sure. Hold on.
Thank you, Ms. Cheryl Salas, for sharing the nutritionist's view on the nutrition quality of diversified diets and the use of fortified staples and nutraceuticals. My special thanks to Dr. Siddharth Wagalkar, who's deputy head nutrition and school feeding unit at World Food Program, why the Indian food sector should adopt fortification of staples and processed foods. Then again, Dr. Nair, a very good presentation by you, a very good explanation on the regulatory support and the enabling environment that is required for scaling of fortification. Dr. Sujit Ranjan, public health and nutrition specialist, on his views on the public-private partnership for improved nutritional outcomes and how we can achieve them and the way forward for it. And though we were unable to hear directly from Mr. Vivek Arora, but his presentation was self-explanatory, and Ms. VP Gulati did a wonderful job in explaining the slides to the delegates. So, and again, a special thanks to Mrs. Deepthi Gulati for wonderful moderation of the entire session and taking up the questions. So thank you all. Thank you all our eminent panelists and all the delegates who are joined in right now for their time. And I hope that everyone has had something to take back from this session today. Thank you again. It's been a pleasure listening to all of you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
One or two questions in panel section is there. So I put the answers organizers can share it with the
Good.
So we'll save the answers, ma'am. Deepanka, if you could save the chat before it is closed.
Even I had the same opinion about millets. I think that is commonly used and we definitely encourage the use of it.
Yeah, I know. That is a new area where we can really get in. That's all. Absolutely. Otherwise, of course, staples are very important today. And we will move on as we grow, as we develop expertise. And anyway, people like Dr. Nair and all that, I think they're all there. And we should make use of the expertise available. And we should be able to move forward in a much better way, because this is the immediate and imminent requirement for the entire country. All the very best. Thank you very much. One second.
There are a lot of universities are working in this area, like the Bikaner Agriculture University. They are working on millets.
I know.
Develop cookies and other things. So yes. a lot of work is already going on for improving the look, and the most important in today's time is branding and packaging.
Yes. I know.
So if you see, a lot of people are moving from potato chips to makhanas now.
Makhana has become the new superfood. Yes. And najni chips also. Ragi chips is like very popular among even a lot of kids. Only thing is it's very high on salt. So that's the only thing what is available commercially.
Yeah. Maybe for the information of everybody here, and we have established an excellent bakery facility. It's a semi-commercial bakery facility where lot many different kinds of products can be made. Probably that is one area where we can work and help anybody if they're really seriously interested, and they can work in our lab and also utilize the facility, especially for producing the bakery products. Of course, that apart, other facilities are also very, everything is put to use now. That's what is, I'm very happy, and people can really come and use the facility. Absolutely, it is good. All the very best.
Sir, I think you should extend an invitation to people to come and visit the NIFTM facilities.
We would love to do that.
Yeah. In fact, our people produced the cookies and the biscuits for the pregnant woman in Kerala, and that was supplied, and it was found to be very good and very positive. They are establishing a bakery plant in Kerala itself, Trivandrum. And so also even the Madhya Pradesh government, they gave a project on specially utilizing the minor millets.
Right.
Yeah, that's where I think that is again another big area where we produced a lot of these bakery products and supplied it to the tribal people. So that is the kutki and those... Yeah, that is again a big area. And in fact, you know, a lot of things need to be really scientifically authenticated.
Are now promoting a lot of these other millets, you know, which are not very popular, but I think it's gaining a lot of popularity and people are becoming very interested also in it.
I just want to add that Delhi University Institute of Home Economics, during the nutrition month, organized a recipe competition using only millets.
Yes.
And it was amazing.
the kind of recipes they had come up with, including milletza, that is the pizza made with millets, yeah. And idlis made with millets, cookies, and the pancakes. So that was very, very amazing, and I'm sure millets would find their rightful place.
Yeah, in fact, we had this for the Eat Right School. We had done this cookery demo where my son actually made a pizza out of ragi. So the base was ragi, and it was so tasty. I can maybe share that video with some of you, and it was really nice. And children liked it so much that they went home and they made it. You know, I think that is the best way to actually spread awareness.
Maybe I think, there are very many people who are involved. I would say last month there was one, the conclave which was organized by IIMR, Indian Institute of Millet Research in Hyderabad. Yeah. And I think more than 400 startups, they participated with various kinds of millet-based products. Absolutely, it is the stage which was created was so big. And learning all those things itself is a big experience. And there are a lot of opportunities, I would say, and very good. And they are doing some of them, especially about 20-25 of them, are doing very good. So we need to emulate such of those experiences. Absolutely.
In Hyderabad, there's some lovely restaurants which only serve food made of millets. I forget the name, but everything is millets, and it's so tasty, and it's like that sattvic food, very nice.
Hyderabad, maybe Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Telangana. Not even Maharashtra. These four states, they are Telangana, Maharashtra, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh.
Yes.
They are really doing good in millets, I would say that. Yeah.
So, sir, before we log out of this virtual session, we would like to invite all of you to give your input so that we can organize something around millets in the near future, maybe in a month or two, where we can have some sort of a hackathon, invite recipes so that something fruitful comes out. I believe the year 2023 has been declared as the International Year for Millets, and they have re-termed as Nutri-Cereals. So PhD would like to take a lead in that with the support of NIFTM, of course, and with our eminent specialists over here, especially Madam Gulati and
PhD, all the others. Now, I would say PhD CCs can step into NIFTM. We will organize at NIFTM. Now, we will collaborate.
Sure, sir.
Absolutely.
Sure, sir. We'll do that. We'll work it that way, sir. I'll take it offline with you. So, now again, thank you everybody for joining in.
Thank you so much. Lovely meeting all of you. Thank you. Bye.
Thanks,
good evening.
Namaskar.